أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولقد جاءكم يوسف من قبل بالبينات And Yusuf عليه السلام had already come to you before with clear proofs. Who says this? The رجل المؤمن. He says that, O people, Yusuf عليه السلام already came to you before with clear evidences showing that he was also a prophet of Allah. Because Yusuf alayhi salam did not only hold a high position in the government, but he was also a messenger. And he called people to Allah. As we have learned that even in jail, what did he do? He called people to the worship of Allah alone. He called people to the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So Yusuf came to you with clear evidences, but what was your reaction with Yusuf alayhi salam? فَمَا زِلْتُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِمَّا جَاءَكُمْ بِهِ But you did not cease to be in doubt concerning what he had brought you. And he called people to Allah. As we have learned that even in jail, what did he do? He called people to the worship of Allah alone. He called people to the religion of Ibrahim a.s. So, Yusuf came to you with clear evidences. But what was your reaction with Yusuf a.s.? فَمَا زِلْتُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِمَّا جَاءَكُمْ بِهِ But you did not cease to be in doubt concerning what he had brought you. Meaning you remained in doubt concerning what he had brought you. زِلْتُمْ from the root letter زَي وَاولَام زَوَال is to disappear, to go away. And مَا زَالَ is to continue, to remain. So زَوَال is to discontinue in a way. But مَا زَالَ with a negative before, what does it mean? To remain, to constantly. So فَمَا زِلْتُمْ فِي شَكٍ You constantly remained in doubt, in uncertainty concerning what Yusuf a.s. had brought you. Meaning you doubted the teachings of Yusuf. That is he really a messenger? Is he not a messenger? Shall we accept what he's saying? Should we not accept what he's saying? And you remained in this doubt حَتَّى until إِذَا هَلَكَ when he died قُلْتُمْ you said, لَنْ يَبْعَثَ اللَّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ رَسُولًا Allah will never send a messenger after him. What does it mean by this statement? That Allah will never send a messenger after him. This statement shows, first of all, their disbelief of Yusuf a.s. And not just of Yusuf a.s. but also of other messengers. That they forgot the religion of Ibrahim a.s. completely, the religion of Yusuf a.s. completely. They said, that's it, no more messengers are coming, we have to make up our own religion, and this is how the people of Fir'aun, they got immersed in idolatry. Because if you think about it, Yusuf a.s., he was there, the Bani Israel were there, Yusuf a.s.'s entire family came to Egypt, there was Tawheed, people respected him, people followed him, however, they did not wholeheartedly accept his message. And when Yusuf a.s. passed away, they said, that's it, no more messengers coming, and this is how they ended up in idolatry, in so many wrong things. Secondly, this statement, لَنْ يَبْعَثَ اللَّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ رَسُولًا This also shows their regret that we've lost our chance. That Yusuf a.s. was such a great man. He was so good. But we did not benefit from him. And now that he's gone, there will be no one that is like him afterwards. لَنْ يَبْعَثَ اللَّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ رَسُولًا كَذَلِكَ يُضِلُّ اللَّهُ مَنْ هُوَ مُسْرِفٌ مُرْتَابٌ Thus does Allah lead astray the one who is an extravagant and also one who is a skeptic. مُرْتَاب is one who entertains a doubt. Meaning a doubter of that which is very clear. So the message of Yusuf a.s. was very clear. But the people, they had doubts about it. فَمَا زِلْتُمْ فِي شَكٍ When they were in shak, they never benefited from Yusuf a.s. When Yusuf a.s. was gone, Then they said, oh, we've missed our chance. No one else will be ever like Yusuf a.s. He was so intelligent, he was so good, he was a man of righteousness, he was so wise in so many ways, we've lost our chance. We see over here that the Rajul al-Mu'min, again he is quoting facts, but what history is he quoting over here? Recent past, isn't it? The people of Nuh, the people of Ad, the people of Thamud, they were ancient. But Yusuf a.s. was in Egypt approximately 400 years before Musa a.s. only. So there was a difference of about only 400 years between Yusuf alayhi salam and Musa alayhi salam. So he's telling them that, look, you did not even learn from Yusuf alayhi salam. He came to you presenting clear signs. You did not believe in him. When you lost him, then you had regrets. Now another messenger has come to you, Musa alayhi salam, and he has brought you clear signs, clear evidences. What are you doing? You're denying him? You're opposing him? When will you learn? You see, the people of Fir'aun, they were very successful in worldly terms. But they suffered from a moral decline. And what was that? That they were musrif and they were murtab. They were extravagant. They crossed all bounds in fulfilling their desires, in accomplishing whatever they wanted. And they were also murtab. They doubted the truth. And we see that people who are suffering from a moral decline, what happens to them? Whatever opportunity is before them, they don't benefit from it. Rather, what do? They dwell in the past, or they're worried about the future. Isn't it? They dwell in the past, or they're worried about their future. لَن يَبْعَثَ اللَّهُ مِن بَعْدِي رَسُولًا. We've lost our chance, past is gone, and in the future, no more hope, so therefore, make up your own way. And we see that the people of Fir'aun, Musa alayhi salam had come to them with clear evidences, clear signs, the staff, the glowing hand, this are ayat. But what was the reaction of the people? They did not accept him. They did not believe in him. So over here, the Rajul al-Mu'min is advising them that when will you learn? When will you value Musa alayhi salam? Now or later? We see that there are many other people as well who don't take advantage from their opportunities. When they lose them, then they regret later on. And this is not just with messengers, with regards to messengers, but also with regards to many other things. Like, for example, when it comes to one's parents, there are people who, when their parents are alive, they don't give them their rights, they don't respect them, they don't take care of them, they don't honor them. And when their parents are gone, then what do? They take one of their very old pictures, they put a huge, you know, the magnified, and they put it up in their living room. I love my father. I love my mother. I have so much respect for them. And the same mother, the same father, what did they want from you? Something else. This is not respect. And then they have regrets. I wish I had served my parents. I wish I had obeyed my parents. But when their parents are alive, they don't take any interest in them. So over here, the Rajul al-Mu'min is telling them that, look at yourself. What are you doing? What kind of a people are you? Allah sent you a messenger before. You did not benefit from him. When he was there, you doubted him. When he was gone, you had regrets. Allah has given you another opportunity. Musa alayhi salam has come to you, and he has brought you clear signs. What are you doing? Will you not learn from your history? Will you not learn from your past? Think about it. He has come, believe in him, and you'll be successful. Because if you reject him, if you deny him, then you will suffer like you suffered before. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ يُجَادِلُونَ فِي آيَاتِ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ. Those people who dispute concerning the signs of Allah without an authority having come to them. Those people who dispute concerning the ayat of Allah. What does it mean by disputing concerning the ayat of Allah? We discussed this yesterday. Okay, trying to refute them. How? By proving them as false. Right? Objecting. Raising objections at the ayat of Allah. Trying to show contradiction in the ayat of Allah. Misinterpreting them, misquoting them. So those people who yujadiluna fi ayatillah, and how do they do jidal in the ayat of Allah? بِغَيْرِ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ. Without any sultan that they have. Sultan over here means authority, meaning they have no authority to do this. They have no authority to try to refute the ayat of Allah, to misquote them, to misinterpret them, to object at them. Because the ayat of Allah, they're from who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who are you? People. What authority do you have to raise objections at the one who is al-alim? You are not alim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Allamul Ghuyub. So you have no authority to raise objections against his ayat. And also بِغَيْرِ سُلْطَانٍ أَتَاهُمْ سُلْطَانٍ, over here is evidence as well. That they tried to do jidal in the ayat of Allah without any evidence. So their argument is based on what? Batil. Such people, كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَعِنْدَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, great is hatred of them in the sight of Allah and also in the sight of those who have believed. كَبُرَ مَقْتًا, great is hatred for who? For who? For those who do jidal in the ayat of Allah without any sultan. Who has maqt against them? Allah, and also who? Alladina amanu, those people who believe. Meaning when a person argues, debates concerning the ayat of Allah without any evidence, without any right, then this is a very hateful action in the sight of Allah. Allah hates it. He detests it. And also this is something very hateful, very disgusting to who? To the believers. So this is a test of iman as well. That if a person is doing jidal in the ayat of Allah, how do we feel? Intimidated? If a person is trying to refute the verses of Allah, we feel, oh my God, they're so knowledgeable. Look at them, they're so fluent. Oh yeah, I never thought about that. We should get impressed by them, influenced by them? No. A believer, when he will find out somebody is doing jidal in the ayat of Allah, he will have maqt for him. He will not like that person, like his argument, even one bit. He will not be impressed by it, he will not be influenced by it. Rather, he will be distressed. And this is a test of iman. A believer can never bear that anyone is speaking against Allah, against his ayat. So كَبُرَ مَقْتًا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَعِنْدَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كَذَلِكَ يَطْبَعُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ قَلْبِ مُتَكَبِّرٍ جَبَّارٍ. Thus does Allah set a seal upon the heart of who? Every heart of who? Mutakabbir and Jabbar. What does it mean by every heart? Does a person have multiple hearts? No. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ قَلْبَيْنِ, right? So Allah has not placed two hearts in the body of a person. Right? So what does it mean by kulli qalb? Meaning every heart that is like this. Every heart that is like this. And who will it belong to? That is of mutakabbir, jabbar. So an arrogant person, a tyrant person, an oppressor, this person Allah sets a seal on his heart. So what happens then? Even when he sees the truth, he doesn't accept it. Why is this mentioned all of a sudden? Fir'aun and his people, what were they doing? Jidal in the ayat of Allah, isn't it? Musa a.s. presented to them clear signs, clear miracles. What did they call them in order to refute them? Magic, lies. So those people who do this, Allah detests them. Allah detests them. And believers also, they detest them. They cannot tolerate that anyone is doing jidal in the ayat of Allah. So when a person has iman, when a person has iman and he witnesses someone doing jidal in the ayat of Allah, can he stay silent? Can he? No. He will get up and he will speak in order to defend the truth. So this rajulul mu'min, he had iman. And because of his iman, he stood up. He spoke up. Even if it meant taking a huge risk, calling a lot of trouble, inviting a lot of trouble. But he stood up. And those people who do jidal in the ayat of Allah, Allah sets a seal upon their hearts. Because they're mutakabbir, they're jabbar, and as a result they don't understand, even if the truth is clear to them. So the rajul mu'min, he made the truth very clear to them. He warned them, he quoted history, he made it very relevant to them, but still did Fir'aun get it? No, he didn't. And as a result, he also led his people astray. Instead of reflecting on what the rajul mu'min was saying, Fir'aun, look at his reaction. وَقَالَ فِرْعَوْنُ, and Fir'aun said, يَا هَامَانُ أُبْنِ لِي صَرْحًا لَعَلِّي أَبْلُغُ الْأَسْبَابِ. O Haman, construct for me a tower that I might reach the ways. Instead of reflecting on what the Rajul Mu'min was saying, he completely diverts the attention of people. And he says something that in a way is funny, humorous. Why? in order to belittle all that that person had said, in order to wash it away. He was warning people, scaring them. People are getting concerned. And as soon as people are getting concerned, they're becoming serious. Fir'aun says something that is extremely silly, so that the people are distracted. He says, O Haman, construct for me, Ibni. This does not mean son over here, but rather it's a fi'l amr. Okay? Banunya, bunyan. Bunyan is, bina is a construction. So construct for me a sarh. Sarh is used for a very tall, a lofty, a huge tower. A lofty structure that's very tall, and it's also decorated from outside. And because it's very tall, it's visible from far as well. So build for me a tower, so that I can go up on it, and I may reach لعلي أبلغ الأسباب. Asbab is a plural of sabab. And sabab is means, right? Anything through which you get to another. Right? Anything through which you attain the desired, the means that you adopt. Primarily the word sabab is used for the rope with which palm trees are climbed. Why do you need to climb up a palm tree? To get the dates, right? A date palm, you go up on it with the help of a rope so that you can get the dates. So this is the primary meaning of the word sabab, and from that it is used for any way that takes you to the desired. So لَعَلِّي أَبْلُغُ الْأَسْبَابِ, I may reach up the means. Which means, which ways? أَسْبَابَ السَّمَاوَاتِ, the ways into the heavens that will take me from one heaven to the other. So build me a huge tower so that I can go from that huge tower up into the heavens, right? That will take me into the roots of the heavens, the paths into the skies, so that I can go from one sky to the other. And then when I will do that, فَأَطَّلِعَ إِلَىٰ إِلَهِ مُوسَى, then I will look to the God of Musa. I will look at him. I will become familiar with him. وَإِنِّي لَأَظُنُّهُ كَاذِبًا, and he says out of his pride that indeed I think him, meaning Musa, to be a liar. That he's lying, that there is another God. So it's as though he is saying that there is no God. I am the only God. This is what he's saying. Because if Musa says there is a God, he's a Rabbus Samawati wal Ard, he's up in the heavens, that I will go up into the heavens and I will go and find if he's really there. And in fact, I don't even think he's there. I think that Musa is lying. وَإِنِّي لَأَظُنُّهُ كَاذِبًا وَكَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِفِرْعَوْنَ سُوءُ عَمَلِهِ. Thus, it was adorned for Fir'aun. What was adorned for Fir'aun? The evil action. The evil of his action. This act of building the tower, of rejecting the truth in mockery, and all of his other evil deeds. It was adorned for him. It was beautified for him. So he thought he was very smart. He thought he was very intelligent. That, oh, look at how I refuted Musa. Look at how I embarrassed him. وَكَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِفِرْعَوْنَ سُوءُ عَمَلِهِ وَصُدَّ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ, and he was prevented from the way. Which way? The way to guidance. Why? Because of his pride. صُدَّ, this is fi'l majhul. He was prevented. This is how he was prevented from the way. How? Because his deeds, his evil deeds, they seemed very good to him. He considered them to be very good, and as a result, he was prevented from the right way. وَمَا كَيْدُ فِرْعَوْنَ إِلَّا فِي تَبَابٍ, and the plot of Fir'aun is not except in ruin, destruction. تَبَاب is from the root letters. تَبَابَ, تَبَّتْ يَدَى أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ, تَبَاب. And تَبَاب is to reach destruction because of suffering one loss after the other. A person remains in loss constantly. He loses one thing after the other, and as a result, finished completely. So وَمَا كَيْدُ فِرْعَوْنَ إِلَّا فِي تَبَابٍ, the plot of Fir'aun to turn people away from Musa a.s., to humiliate Musa a.s., to humiliate the believers, this entire plot, it only ended in ruin and loss. No matter what he did, he was a failure. If you think about the Rajul al-Mu'min, he was so serious in his speech, isn't it? So serious that he is warning the people. He is presenting facts before people. And look at Fir'aun when he realizes that the situation is slipping out of his hands. And in order that people don't take any effect, he immediately changes the topic and he says something that's very silly, so that people don't get affected. And you will find this as well, that sometimes you're saying something, you really mean it, and the other person just cracks one joke, and whatever you were saying has no effect whatsoever. It goes down the drain. It completely gets washed away. This is what Fir'aun did. But look at the Rajul Mu'min, he remained firm. وَقَالَ الَّذِي آمَنَ And the one who had believed, he said, يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُونِي O my people, follow me. أَهْدِكُمْ سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ I will guide you to the right way, to the way of right conduct. He completely ignores what Fir'aun had said. Because you know people who say such things, who say silly things, people don't give any importance to them. They don't give any importance to them. So the Rajul Mu'min, he continues that, O my people, ittabi'uni, follow me, do what I say, believe as I have believed, just listen to me. Ahdikum sabila rashad, I will guide you to the way of rectitude. Now think about it, Musa alayhi salam was there. So why does this Rajul Mu'min say, follow me? Why doesn't he say, follow Musa alayhi salam? Because essentially he was calling to the same thing, right? He's talking to his people. He is presenting his own example. Do what I have done. Follow me, follow my way. That despite the fact that Fir'aun is not a believer, I have believed. Despite the fact that the majority has not believed, still I have believed. Because when the truth is clear, that's what you should do. So follow my way. He's presenting his example, and although the messenger is present, but he is calling people to believe in the messenger. So, يَا قَوْمِ اتَّبِعُونِي أَهْدِكُمْ سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ يَا قَوْمِ O my people, إِنَّمَا هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا مَتَاعُ This worldly life is only temporary enjoyment. This dunya, the life of this world, is just temporary enjoyment. It is insignificant, it is short-lived, and very soon it will diminish, very soon it will pass away, very soon your life will come to an end. This life is temporary. It's a mata. It's a temporary enjoyment. وَإِنَّ الْآخِرَةِ And indeed the hereafter, هِيَ دَارُ الْقَرَارِ That is the home of settlement. That is the home of stay. That is the home of stability. قَرَار قَرَار is the place to settle down and stay somewhere. It's a place that is stable. So, دَارُ الْقَرَارِ That is the enduring abode, the permanent abode. That is a place where we will be forever. So why do you run after this dunya? The hereafter, the home of the hereafter, that is Darul Khulud, Darul Baqa. Dunya, it's nothing. It's matar. It's enjoyed for a little and then it comes to an end. Because if you think about it, this Rajulul Mu'min, when he became a believer, he was putting everything he had at risk. Isn't it? He belonged to the royal family. Okay, he had a lot. However, if he were to become a believer, then Fir'aun would not spare anyone. If he were to spare anyone, he would have spared his wife. But he even persecuted her. Musa alayhi salam, he was raised in the house of Fir'aun. Wasn't he? But Musa alayhi salam claimed to be a prophet. He came as a messenger before him. And he did not give any importance whatsoever to Musa alayhi salam. So anyone who became a believer lost everything of the dunya in that society. The Bani Israel, they were believers, what did they have? Nothing. So this man was putting everything at risk. But he tells the people that look, this dunya, after all, it's only a matar. It's only temporary enjoyment. The real home is the home of the hereafter. That is the permanent home. So what have we prepared for it? What have you done for it? So he mentally prepares them. Do not sell your hereafter for this dunya. This dunya is very tempting. Fir'aun, whatever he's offering, very tempting. And on the other hand, losing all this dunya, very difficult. But think about it. This dunya is nothing compared to the hereafter. So don't lose your akhirah because of this dunya. مَنْ عَمِلَ سَيِّئَةً Whoever does an evil deed, فَلَا يُجُزَى إِلَّا مِثْلَهَا Then he will not be recompensed except by the like of it. If a person does something evil, that's exactly what he will get. And on the other hand, وَمَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا, and whoever does righteous deed, مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى, from a male or a female, whether man or a woman. But what's the condition? وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ, he has to be a believer. فَأُولَٰئِكَ يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ, then those, they will enter Jannah. يُرْزَقُونَ فِيهَا بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, they will be provided in there without any measure, without any account. No bills will be sent to the people of Jannah that you have consumed so much, so this is how much you have to pay. No. يُرْزَقُونَ فِيهَا بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, the reward cannot be enumerated. And Allah, He will give immense reward without any end. So look at the good news that He's giving to the people over here as well. That if you believe, okay, you will lose some dunya, but if you think about it, if you do something evil, you will receive its punishment in the hereafter. But if you do good with iman, then the reward is endless. Reward is endless. فَأُولَٰئِكَ يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ يُرْزَقُونَ فِيهَا بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. In Surah An-Nahl, Ayah 97, Allah says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. That whoever does righteousness, whether male or female, while he is a believer, we will surely cause him to live a good life. And this good life is both in dunya and also in akhirah. And we will surely give them their reward in the hereafter according to the best of what they used to do. In Surah Al-Kahf, Ayah 2, وَيُبَشِّرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا حَسَنًا, a beautiful reward, an excellent reward. And over here, بِغَيْرِ حِسَاب. And بِغَيْرِ حِسَاب, what does it mean? It has several meanings. Of them is, without being called to account for it. That you have consumed so much, this is your limit, this is the budget. No. And بِغَيْرِ حِسَاب also, that without any limit. Without any limit. So فَأُولَٰئِكَ يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ يُرْزَقُونَ فِيهَا بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. So he gave the warning. He's also giving good news. وَيَا قَوْمِ, and O my people, مَالِي, how is it that أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاتِ, I invite you to salvation, وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ, while you invite me to the fire? وَيَا قَوْمِ مَالِي, مَالِي literally means what is for me. And over here, it's as though he's saying, what is this? What's going on? How come the situation is that when it comes to me, I am calling you to Najat, and when it comes to you, you're calling to hellfire? And also, Mali can be understood as Mali wa Malakum, meaning what's with me and what's with you? Look at my situation, look at your situation. What's going on? How is it that أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاتِ, I am calling you to salvation. How? How? That you believe in Allah and you will be saved. وَتَدْعُونَنِي, and you, what are you calling me? إِلَى النَّارِ, to the fire. You're calling me to that which leads to hellfire. And what is it? The worship of other than Allah. Disbelief in messengers. And if you look at it, he was only one person and they were a majority. He was only one, and the rest of the people, who were they? Mushrik. Now, what do we see? That despite the fact that those upon the truth are a minority, a person must hold on to the truth. And those upon falsehood are a majority, still you don't hold on to falsehood. So the criteria for truth and falsehood is not minority-majority, but what is it? The truth itself, the falsehood itself. تَدْعُونَنِي, you're calling me. Because imagine, all the people were calling him, right? Because indirectly, Fir'aun, his entire nation, who were they? Mushrikeen. So anyone who became a believer was discouraged. تَدْعُونَنِي, you are inviting me, لِأَكْفُرَ بِاللَّهِ, that I disbelieve in Allah. وَأُشْرِكَ بِهِ, and that I associate with him. This is what you're calling me to. And this, مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِهِ عِلْمٍ, if I associate partners with Allah, I have no ilm for that. Ilm over here means evidence. Meaning I have no evidence that supports that Allah has a partner. When it comes to the evidences of Tawheed, many have been presented before you. Musa alayhi salam gave them many evidences. But when it comes to your shirk, when it comes to associating partners with Allah, what evidence do we have? Nothing. وَأَنَا أَدْعُوكُمْ And I am calling you إِلَى الْعَزِيزِ الْغَفَّارِ To the one who is exalted in might, the perpetual forgiver. There is warning, and there is also hope. I am calling you to the one who is Aziz. If you disbelieve in him, if you disobey him, consequences are serious. And at the same time, he is Ghaffar. If you turn to him, he will forgive you. You believe in him, he will forgive you. This is da'wah ila Allah. Balance. Don't make people so hopeful. Oh yeah, everything is right. And don't scare people too much. No matter what you do, you're going to hellfire. No. Call people to who? Al-Aziz, Al-Ghaffar. And this is also da'wah ila Allah. Calling people to Allah, not to yourself. Not to a person, but rather calling people to the worship of Allah alone. You're calling me to kufr. You're calling me to shirk. And I am calling you to Allah alone.